محمد. وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المنتجبين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. صلى الله عليك يا سيدي ويا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله، صلى الله عليك يا ابن رسول الله يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة الأمة يا غريب كربلاء، يا ليتنا يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والذين إذا فعلوا فاحشة أو ظلموا أنفسهم ذكروا الله فاستغفروا لذنوبهم ومن يغفر الذنوب إلا الله ولم يصروا على ما فعلوا وهم يعلمون. صدق الله العلي العظيم. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد.
Societies experience social problems, and it is important for them to first of all recognize the problems, and second, develop institutions that can deal with such problems. For example, back when I was doing my doctorate degree, I used to take the transit system, the bus. In the bus, there was an advertisement. In that advertisement, it had playing cards, you know, pictures of playing cards. The king, the queen, the jack, but all with sad faces. And the ad read, "Do you have a gambling problem? If so, contact this number," for example, "or visit this website." What this suggests is that the ad, of course, it said, you know, in the very fine print that it is sponsored by some, you know, provincial government or some government agency. What this suggests is that the government has recognized gambling is a problem. It's causing a problem in the society. And therefore, they're now establishing this resource center or quote-unquote institution that can help people deal with this problem. People, of course, when they gamble, they start getting addicted to it. And what ends up happening is they start losing their money, and as a consequence to money, they might lose even other things like their homes, other belongings. This could lead to even bigger problems. Some people, for example, cannot cope with these problems. So what do? They want to escape reality by turning to alcohol, for example, or to drugs, to escape with the reality. To think that, you know what, these will make us forget. And this would lead to another, and so on and so forth. Or an incident that happened about 10 years ago, which was very sad and morbid. A man who was a Muslim, he went and gambled and lost everything. He came back home at night, killed his entire family and then killed himself. What is suicide? Because he just did not want to see his family suffer after what he has done. So this society realized there is a problem here. People are suffering, so they established this institution to deal with this problem. You find, for example, when it comes to pregnancies without marriage, that is a big problem in the society. So societies, they started to establish institutions to deal with these problems. A man and a woman have a relationship and then she ends up with a child or pregnant with one. And this is not an easy thing. Now he has fun, he had his fun. When she approaches him about the reality, he says, you know, this is your problem, you deal with it. And he leaves. It's not an easy thing for the woman to cope with. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he talks about pregnancy, he says, حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ وَهْنًا عَلَىٰ وَهْنٍ. His mother carried him in stages of weakness after weakness. Indeed, you ask the mother who is pregnant, as the child develops further and further, her strength weakens. This is just the physical aspect of things. Now imagine if you add some psychological problems in there, where the woman, for example, has nobody to help her. That creates a problem in the society. It creates emotional problems, psychological problems. And then when this child is born, there is no father, there is no support. The woman finds herself all by herself. That causes sometimes depression to many ladies. In fact, there is a symptom called post-birth depression. People who develop depression because of delivery, because the woman's life changes completely with the child. Now, when she's all alone, it's not an easy thing. And this also has further consequences. This has further consequences. This woman, they found in studies, in research studies, that women who have children at such young age with no help, no support, their rates of dropping out of schools are much higher. The success rate of the child is much lower. The finances that it cost the government, and that's really a big deal for them, the finance, money, everything is money. It costs a lot of money for the government to look after these people. So you find them establishing these institutions where they say, for example, don't have relationships, abstinence. Or if you want to have relationship, then try not to have a pregnancy. And so on and so forth. They start to establish some institutions like this to deal with these problems. And I'll come back to the solutions that they propose. I'll come back to that shortly. Other problems you have, for example, is drugs and alcohol. Major problem. A major problem that, unfortunately, this problem is also infiltrating in Muslim societies, and let's be honest, in even some of our own communities. These problems are coming to our communities. But some people choose to turn the blind eye method. You know, if I can't see it, then it doesn't exist. And this is not the solution. Let's be realistic. A person cannot solve a problem by turning his eyesight away from it. A person must stand there and solve the problem. Face it. It's not easy, of course. It's much easier to turn the eye and say, no, it's not happening. But true leadership requires that a person stands and solve these issues. I mean, Amir al-Mu'mineen, salamullahi alayhi, when he became, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he became the Khalifa, Talha and Zubayr came and paid their allegiance to him in the beginning. They did the bay'ah. People told Imam Ali alayhi salam, they said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, Talha and Zubayr are looking for positions in the government, posts. So why don't you win them over
by giving them positions in the government. End of the problem. Make him a governor somewhere, a city somewhere, make him a governor. And this way you'll have them on your side.
But this is where the difficult decision is. This is where leadership comes out.
Imam Ali could have said, okay, no problem.
خلاص طلحة, I'll make you the governor of this city, for example.
Zubair, I will make you governor of that city, for example.
And they would have been happy, and a whole battle would have been, or may have been, avoided.
But is this really the way that Amir al-Mu'mineen deals with problems? Of course not. He says, we appoint people not because we want to win them over, but rather because they deserve the position. Doesn't matter whether I want them over or don't want them over. These people have interests. They're there for an interest. How can I keep such a position, such an individual in such major position, a governor? Can't accept that. And that's where leadership comes in. It was not easy. It was difficult. And they came to Ali ibn Abi Talib, salamullah alayhi. They came to him. One day Ammar ibn Yasir was distributing some money to the Muslims. He distributed to them, he gave Talha, he gave Zubair, like what he gave to the rest of the Muslims. So they came, they objected. They said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, why are you giving us the same money that you give to the rest of the people? He said, why not? He said, well, your predecessors, they used to distinguish Arabs versus non-Arabs. Arabs would get paid more than non-Arabs. People of Quraysh would get paid more than people who were not from Quraysh. They were now what you can call, quote unquote, a caste system. So there are ranks. And why? They gave justifications. The second Khalifa said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, those who became Muslims before the conquest of Mecca, before the fatah of Mecca, are not equal to those who became Muslims after the conquest of Mecca. So he said, therefore, based on this ayah, we cannot pay them both equally. This is not how you interpret the ayah. The ayah is not referring about the payment. Nonetheless, so he came up with this justification for it. And hence he created this caste system, this ranking system. You're from Quraysh, you get paid more. You're not from Quraysh, you're less. You're an Arab, you get paid more. You're not an Arab, you get paid less. Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullahi alayhi came to equalize. He said, no, this is not the system of Islam. Everyone gets paid the same. So they came and they objected. They said, your predecessors paid us more. He said, well, why do you think you deserve to get paid more? Tell me. Okay. Let's have a logical discussion here. And this is the approach of Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullahi alayhi. That when people object, talk it out with them. Don't just brush them off. He could have said, Ana Ali ibn Abi Talib, Khalifa Rasulullah, and get out of my face. Who are you to talk? But this is not the approach. It's not how you deal with a problem. You try to calm down the situation, make people understand, solve the problem. Don't turn a blind eye to it and think it doesn't exist. He sat down. He said, tell me, why do you think you deserve more? He said, well, because we were among the first people to become Muslims from Quraysh. That's one. Two, because of our closeness to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Zubair was a cousin of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. His cousin from his mother's side, Safiya. First cousins. And Talha's from Quraysh. Therefore he has, you know, some relationships, distant relationships. So because one, we became Muslims among the early Muslims. And second, because we're closer to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. So the Imam Ali said, okay, so if this is your argument, okay, so let's come to this argument. He said, who became Muslim first, you or me? He said, you, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. Okay. Who's closer to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, you or me? He said, you're closer to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. He said, if that is the case, then your argument is invalid, because I am getting paid just like what you guys are getting paid.
and I'm the Khalifa of the Muslims. So if your argument is because you should get deserve more because you become Muslim before, or because you're close, your argument is invalid. I've become Muslim before you, and I'm closer to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi than you, and yet I am still being paid whatever. You know, this is equal pay for everyone else. Although Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullah alayhi, when he came to Khilafah, he did not take a penny from Baytul Mal. He had a farmland. He had a land that he used to farm in Medina. Whatever that land used to bring him, that's what he used to spend from. But he was trying to tell them that, you know what? This pay is equal to everyone. Everyone. We're all the same here. We're all the same. So, this is how you face the problem. And this caused a problem. This caused a problem. They didn't like it, and hence they went ahead and they fought this war against the Amir, salamullahi alayhi. And they brought this other woman with them. So you don't solve a problem by turning a blind eye to it or by trying to win people over. This is not the spirit of the mu'mineen. Face them. So coming back, this drugs and alcohol, it's a problem. It's a problem that is infiltrating our communities, our societies. And Islam came to say haram. You cannot do this. This is a problem. And what do they try to do again? The society recognizes there is an alcohol problem, drugs and addiction problem. So they open these alcohol clinics, they open these rehab clinics, they try to educate people about alcohol. What do they say? Drink with moderation. Drink with moderation. I remember a few years ago, I was reading in the paper, I remember, December 31st, and I was in the United Kingdom at that time. Not too long ago, a few years ago. December 31st, I was reading the newspaper in the UK. They were talking about a phenomena that Brightons are famous for, especially New Year's Eve, and that is known as binge drinking. Binge drinking. Brightons, I guess you guys like that stuff, you know. Not you guys, inshallah, but I mean, the British people. So, one member of parliament was saying that binge drinking on New Year's Eve makes people so intoxicated that their body becomes toxicated. You know, the body becomes toxic. It's filled with toxic. So what happens? Those people then end up in the hospital and they have to be treated. Each person costs the taxpayers £500. He said a total of £22 million are spent on this one night treating those people. £22 million are spent on this one night only. One night. Trying to treat these people from the toxicity. So this one member of parliament suggested that we have to put a penalty. Anyone who comes to the hospital because of this, they have to pay the £500. No. Of course, the bill was killed immediately in the parliament. You know, it did not even get discussed. All these are what's called as band-aid solutions. Band-aid solutions. No, this poor thing, you know, this is band-aid solution as well. What's wrong with this monkey tonight? What have you done to it? Yeah. It's good, at least they turned the lights on in the back there. That's a good thing, alhamdulillah, mashallah. Now I can see what's going on there, you know. So, band-aid solutions. Islam, however, does not offer band-aid solutions. Islam offers root solution. You solve the problem from the roots. From the roots. Islam came to say gambling is haram. It's not allowed. Islam came to say alcohol and drugs are haram. They're not allowed. Islam came to say that premarital relationships are haram. They're not allowed. And Islam is introducing all these measures not just so that, you know, let's wait for the problem to happen and then figure out how to solve it. No, from the beginning you prevent it. I mentioned last night in the lecture, those of you who remember, I said there is something in medicine called preventative medicine, where you try to prevent the disease before it happens. And hence you find people, for example, in certain seasons, they give immunizations. In fact, the government itself might sponsor immunization shots. Free. They give you immunizations. Why? What for? They're trying to prevent you from getting ill
So they immunize your body to prevent the illness, as opposed to wait for you to become ill and then go and hospitalize you and then treat you. So this prevention, it's greater, it's best, it's good. Try it. Islam comes to say this. We prevent the problem from the beginning. We don't wait for the problem to happen and then let me think, how am I going to solve it with some band-aid solutions? Every day in Canada, where I come from, every day, 4 people die from drinking-related accidents. Every day, 4 people from drinking-related accidents. Imagine, every day. So, you don't come and you introduce alcohol into the society, and of course, it's a multi-billion-dollar industry. That's a multi-billion-dollar industry, if not more than that. Gambling is a multi-billion-dollar industry, if not more than that. And this is one of the reasons, mu'mineen and mu'minat, there is this warfare against Islam altogether. Because Islam comes to combat gambling, comes to combat alcohol. This threatens the businesses of many, many people. Billions of dollars are at stake, if not trillions of dollars are at stake here. If you come, this is without even talking about the interest system. That's a separate thing altogether, you know. That, inshallah, maybe we can address it later. So Islam comes as a threat. Islam, imagine if Islam is imposed all over the world, or people become Muslims all over the world. What happens? Many corporations will be out of business. Trillions of dollars will be gone. That's not good. That doesn't sound very good. Society say, no, some people, let them make as much money as they can, and the rest of the people, let them suffer. We don't care. Who cares? No, let them suffer. They want to have addiction problems, gambling problems. This is their problem, not our problems. Islam comes from the beginning to say, no, put these red lines, haram. Some people say, why Islam is so strict, for example, about men and women relationship who are not mahram? Why is it haram to even shake the hand of someone who is not a mahram? Because Islam wants to prevent. From the beginning, you prevent it. Why is it haram that, for example, a man and a woman cannot get together in privacy if they're not mahram? From the beginning, stop the problem. Prevent it. Don't wait for the problem to occur and then figure out, what am I going to do now? Solve it from the beginning. So Islam came to introduce all these measures for a reason, for a reason. And we need to do the same, brothers and sisters. These institutions that they've established, again, they're band-aid solutions. We have many, unfortunately, of our youths who don't understand this, and therefore you find them sometimes, unfortunately, gone into these problems. Addiction problems, drug and alcohol problems, premarital relationship problems, maybe even gambling problems. They have them. It's a problem. It's a huge problem. But they stem from maybe a bigger problem. And the question is, why are these youths who come from Muslim families or Islamic homes driven to such venues? What is the problem here? And this could suggest a bigger problem. It may suggest that there's a problem in the house. A house which has no tranquility, no serenity. For example, maybe the parents are constantly arguing and fighting. Or you have a separation. Or you might have, for example, the father and the mother busy working and not paying much attention to raising their children. They don't spend time with their children. All these and many other issues could lead to a vacuum in the life of the child. And this vacuum, this problems, is not shown until this child becomes a teenager. When he or she becomes a teenager, then you realize that, my goodness, this is what this individual has done. But we need to clarify these problems. This drinking, these problems. You know, interestingly, with alcohol, there is a mythical story. It's a mythical, it's not a true story. But it's interesting. The story goes that when the grapevine was first planted, when it was first planted, Iblis came, Shaitan came, and he slaughtered a peacock on that vine, a peacock. So the blood of the peacock went into the root of the vine and the vine basically sucked it. Then he came and he slaughtered a monkey. Again, the blood of the monkey went into the root of the vine and the vine sucked it. Then he came and he slaughtered a lion. And again, the blood of the lion went into the root and the vine sucked it. And then he came and slaughtered a pig. And then the blood of the pig came and went up. Therefore, it suggests, you know, that the story goes, when you find a person drinking, when you find a person drinking, at first, when he first drinks, his color changes, the color changes like a peacock, and he starts feeling arrogant like a peacock, you know, that there's nobody like me, you know, that kind of feeling, you know, that alhamdulillah, I don't know what's it like, because alhamdulillah, I've never experienced it, but, you know, people have that feeling of feeling this arrogant pride, okay, initially. Then slowly, once the intoxication starts, you find them behaving like monkeys, jumping up and down, clapping, you know, behaving like monkeys, you know. Then you find them roaring like lions, breaking, fighting. How many times have you seen people fighting, you know, for example, they get drunk and they fight, they get aggressive, they fight. Domestic violence, so many cases of domestic violence gets reported because of drinking. The man comes home, he doesn't even know what he's doing. And he beats the wife, he beats the children, and so on and so forth. He, like a lion, he becomes vicious, like a lion. And then, after all this, he falls down and crashes like a pig, basically. Just crashes, and just wants to sleep, and doesn't want anyone to bother him or her. And then is bothered with the hangover the next day. You know, he has to deal with it, you know. So it's a mythical story, but it's interesting, you know, in the sense, you know, it's not a true story, but it's interesting how it describes the character or the behavior of a person who gets drunk, you know, from these four animals. Nonetheless, if we describe this to people, if we describe them about the problems, when Islam came first of all to say this is haram, but then it started describing to people, listen, these issues will cause huge problem in the society. Gambling will suck your blood out, will suck all your money out. This will cause a huge problem in the society. It will make certain people rich, very few individuals wealthy, but the rest will become poor. And this might cause other social relationships, like suicide, wal-iyadu billah, like what happened in the other case that I mentioned a few years ago, or divorces, or problems. Islam came and said, hold on a second, don't do this, it's haram. And Islam explained it. Drinking, Islam said, don't drink, because then you will lose your mind. And when you lose your mind, you'll have major issues. Plus, addiction is another problem. You become addicted to this. And you think that, you know what, for me, let me escape reality. And instead of confronting it, people drink. This is not a solution. This is not the way to face your problems. Sit down and figure out how am I going to solve my problems. Not by going and drinking or doing drugs, wal-iyadu billah. Islam came and said, premarital relationships are not allowed. Because there are consequences here. The child needs a father and a mother, needs responsibility. It is not just enjoy for a few minutes and that's it, it's done. There are consequences. These issues have emotional effects on the individuals involved, psychological effects on the individuals involved. And this is what recent research is showing, recent literature is showing these. When it shows, for example, as I mentioned earlier, that people who have children without any premarital relationships, without any marriage relations, they become single parents, for example, they don't look after the child, these children are more likely to fail in life. These parents are more likely not to succeed in life. All these are reasons when Islam comes and says all this. Subhanallah, it's just one word or three words. Three words that make a haram into halal between a man and a woman. Three words. The woman says, Zawajtuka nafsi, and he says, Qabiltu. Khalas. Subhanallah. Just three words, yet they have such great importance. Why? Because they bring responsibility. Bring responsibility. Somebody says, only three. One day a man came to one of the ulama. He came to the ulama in a majlis. And the guy, you know, he had studied in the West.
He got in his doctorate degree in the West, and he thinks, "Khalas, you know, now that I have my doctorate degree, I know everything. You know, that's it. You know, how some people are like that. You know, I'm a doctor, so I know everything. You know, why? How do you know everything? Anyways, some people, or some people say, you know, I'm a successful businessman. I know, I have been in business so many years. I know all the ins and outs. So I know everything. How do you know everything, ya akhi? You only know business. So stay with business. Don't get out of your path." But some people, unfortunately, their egos develop. You know, as the Quran says, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَيَطْغَى أَرْرَآهُ اسْتَغْنَى. When the human being finds himself becoming more wealthy or more knowledgeable, all of a sudden his طغيان starts to increase. His arrogance starts to increase. You know, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَيَطْغَى أَرْرَآهُ اسْتَغْنَى. You know, but then Allah responds, Allah says to him, remind this human being that he's going to come back to his Lord, huh? إِنَّ إِلَى رَبِّكَ الرُّجْعَى. They'll come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So don't feel so much like a peacock, you know, so proud of yourself. Take it easy. So this man came to this alim, you know, thinking that he knows everything. He's a doctor. And he was just talking. There were people sitting down in the majlis. He says, you know, I studied in the West. We studied medical, for example, research and things like that. What's the point of this marriage? You know, this man says to the woman, or the woman says the wash to the nafsi, he says qabil to. What's the point of all this? Oh, nonsense. Few words. How will these words change anything? You know, they can still have children. Physiologically speaking, these children are exactly the same. There is nothing on the effect of the children. You know, it's a boy here, girl here, girl. What's the difference? This alim saw those people sitting around, started to get brainwashed a little bit, you know. He said, yeah, that's true. You know how sometimes some people, especially those who don't have Islamic education. Like I said yesterday or a couple days ago in the khutbah, I said shubuhat, when they come, you know, these tests or these issues, when they arise, they don't come writing on their forehead that I am a shubuha, I'm a falsehood. Batil, when it comes, it doesn't write on its forehead, I'm batil. It comes and it's initially, if you look at it outside without examination, it looks really justifiable, it looks logical. Once you dig deeper though, you find it's just a shell. No core. That's when batil happens. So this alim saw this. A problem started to arise. So he wanted to finish the discussion from the beginning. He looked at this man and he told him in Arabic, he told him basically, shut up. Shut up. This guy is a doctor, you know. He became so angry. He's never heard anyone telling him this before. In the front of everyone, what an insult. So his face turned red, you know, his face turned red. He was so angry. He got up and left. The alim told everyone, nobody leaves. You all stay. He stayed there for some time. After some time, you know, a couple hours later, this alim said to everyone, he said, let us go now visit this man in his house. Let's go to his house. Now, what's wrong with this monkey? Why is this happening? This man? I don't know. Okay. It's all because of this. You know, this. I don't know what this is. So he said, let's go to this man's house. So they all come with him, they knock on his door, he opens the door, he finds this alim is at his door. Now of course, you know, he doesn't want to tell the alim, get out, you know, you just insulted me. He feels embarrassed a little bit. The alim is at his door, says, okay, come on in, please, come on in. The alim sat down, he said to him, in front of everyone, he said, look, this is everyone that was present there, and in front of all of them, I would like to apologize to you. I'm here to apologize to you. But he said, I have a question for you. He said, what is it? He said, if words don't really matter and have no effect, why is it that when I told you shut up, you became so angry, your face turned red? He said, your face, how does it turn red? Your blood, you know, the blood came into your face and that's how you became so red. So few words had such a major physiological impact on you. Not just physiological impact, psychological impact, emotional impact, that made you really get angry, get upset, furious. He said, if words have no value, then why did you get so upset? Why did it really influence you? He said, don't underestimate the power of words. Because that was his argument. His argument was words, you know. He just says, awashtuka qabiltu. I mean, what's the point of it? Just words. He said, these words, don't underestimate words. He said, these words make it from haram into halal. They're not easy. They're valuable words. And it introduces commitment. Like I said, it introduces commitment. Why is it that, you know, sometimes major corporations, those of you, mashallah, Khojas are very good in business. When you guys do business, what is it? The first thing you do, a contract. Right? Contract. Anything. You talk to a Khoja, you want to talk to him, says contract. Sign. Please. You know. So I want to invite you to my house. Contract. Why contract? Contract. Otherwise you might sue me. You know. Contract. So everything, why is it that the contract, why do you do a contract? Just words. Well, you know, I will sell you this much, you pay me. Everything has to be a contract. In fact, even Quran says, do a contract when you do businesses. So you guys are doing a good job, mashallah. You know, Khojas love that part of the Quran. They adhere to it very religiously, you know, that part. Hijab? No, take it off. No, that part, no, don't buy it. Never mind. So, it's good. It's because it's important. You have a, let's say, a 100,000 deal, or a million, or even 10-pound deal. You want to guarantee your rights, so you do a contract. With this contract, what's the point of the contract? What does it serve? Just ink on paper. That's what a contract is, ink on paper. But this ink on paper guarantees your rights and the other party's rights. If any problem arises, you can go to al-hakim al-shar'i, for example, to a judge, and you can get justice. Here, there is a commitment now. There is a binding contract. There is a commitment from both parties. In marriage, remember, it's a contract. عَقْدٌ نِكَاحَ عَقْدٌ. It's a contract. That's why a woman can put conditions in the contract. A man can put conditions in the contract. Can put conditions. No. People are wondering, conditions. Now, I was never told this. No. I won't tell you because I want to create problems right now, you know, so. You can have conditions though, I will stop there. I won't say what kind of conditions you can have. But, you can have, it's a contract. So you can have conditions. And according to the Islamic law, these conditions must be met and adhered to. If the party, one of the party does not adhere to these conditions, the woman or the man have a right to go to Al-Hakim al-Shar'i, to, for example, the Marji' or the Institute of the Marji' and to complain. And they have all the right to have their right served. It's a contract, so it's a commitment. When a child is born, a man cannot say, you know what, none of my business, you deal with it. No, yaakhi. Good luck. He's your son, she's your daughter, you have to look after them now. You have to raise them, you have to feed them, you have to educate them, teach them. This is your religious responsibility. When you said qabiltu, now you abided by this contract. So all these are important. Islam comes to explain all these. Explain them. And when people understand them, they understand these. However, when problems do arise in the society, there has to be institutions for people to go back to. Problems will arise in a society, in a community. For example, a community should have a social branch. A social branch. The responsibility, the social branch should consist maybe of one lawyer, one psychologist, one medical doctor, one counselor, for example, should have males and females, and they should be independent from the community. This council, this social committee, let's say, they are independent from the community at large. They're independent. This way, any man or woman suffering from a problem, suppose somebody has an alcohol problem, an addiction problem, he wants to get some cure. So this social committee, he can go to it and it will address his issues and his concerns with utmost privacy, because sometimes, you know, a person comes and the biggest fear is that the minute I see this, immediately on the internet, did you know this guy is doing this and this? But this has to be utmost private. That's why it should be independent from the community. Set up by the community, a committee, but it's independent. And they're obliged by law to keep everything private, just like legal disclaimer, you know, they cannot, the law, a lawyer cannot disclaim, a doctor cannot disclaim, psychologist, professional psychologist, and so on and so forth. So you have this entity, you have this organization that can serve the problems of the community when they arise. When a person has a problem, he knows he can turn to this branch. And he knows or she knows that this is total privacy. Nobody will ever know anything about this. No one. Then you have a successful organization. That's why they have all these helplines. This is kind of a help committee, social committee.
These are important to address these issues. Otherwise, problems will continue to grow and grow and grow until one day they'll become, you know, if they're hidden, no one talks about them, one day everybody will know about them. Just can't contain them anymore. These rehab institutions are important, and Islam introduced a form of this rehab institution through the concept of istighfar. Istighfar. Tawbah. This is a form of this rehab institution. When a person is carried away, his desires carries him away to perform something haram. He knows the gate of tawbah is open. He can't go back to Allah. He can't seek this rehab. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala kept this gate open to treat these problems. Now of course, like I said, when you have the social committee, certain individuals, they might need treatment. Addiction needs treatment. You might need treatment. Some people are addicted to alcohol, some people are addicted to drugs, some people addicted to looking at the haram. They have an addiction of looking at the haram and forcing some bodily fluids out of their body, which is a major sin, haram. Some of the men, they have this issue, but some people don't want to talk about it. This is haram. And when you talk to them, they say, I'm addicted to it. Well, you need to seek help. Seek help. Don't be in the state of denial, because that is a problem in its own. Some people say, I don't have a problem. That's a state of denial. State of denial is a problem in its own. You bring somebody, for example, with a heart condition, the doctor says, take this medication. He says, no, I'm not sick. Yeah, no, you are. You need this medication. The problem is you have to convince him first that he needs it. That's denial. And then you give him the medication. So this is an issue as well. All these are issues. They need to be dealt with. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala kept this gate of istighfar open. It's an institution to rehab. To rehab. To cleanse one's heart. To go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in these ayat, وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا فَعَلُوا فَاحِشَةً. This ayah from Surah Ali Imran. وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا فَعَلُوا فَاحِشَةً أَوْ ظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ ذَكَرُوا اللَّهِ فَاسْتَغْفَرُوا لِذُنُوبِهِمْ. Those who when they commit فَاحِشَةً وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. فَاحِشَة is an act which is very bad. Very bad act. In the language, it's mostly associated with zina wal-iyadu billah. Zina is referred to as fahisha. Premarital relationships, adultery, fornication, wal-iyadu billah, that's zina. It's usually referred to as fahisha. But it also includes or may include major sins. Major sins as well. Major sins are also bad. Disrespecting the parents, for example, is a major sin. Doing ghiba of a mu'min is a major sin. These major sins are considered, could be considered as fahisha. So Allah says, وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا فَعَلُوا فَاحِشَةً. They commit a major sin. أَوْ ظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ. Or they oppress themselves, which could be in a reference to a minor sin. A minor sin. One should not take minor sins lightly either. Someone says, you know, alhamdulillah, I pray, I fast, I do all these things, I'm a good boy, but I listen to music. Well, don't take music lightly. It's a minor sin. And the fuqaha say, insisting on a minor sin turns it into a major sin. It's a minor sin, but you insist on it. That turns it into a major sin. Plus Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam says, اتقوا صلى الله على محمد. He says, اتقوا المحقرات من الذنوب فإنها لا تغفر. He says, avoid these minor sins, what you may think it's a minor sin, because these minor sins may never be forgiven. They may never be forgiven. And it's a chain. A person performs one small sin, then he performs another one and another one, until God forbid, he ends up into the hellfire. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. It's a problem. So, the ayah says, and those who perform major sins or minor sins, ذَكَرُ اللَّهِ. They remember Allah. They turn to Allah. فَاسْتَغْفَرُوا لِذُنُوبِهِمْ. They ask for repentance. Istighfar. Tawbah. Forgiveness. They turn to Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to encourage the mu'mineen and says, وَمَنْ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Who would forgive the sins other than
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So mu'mineen, come back to Allah. Go back to me. Don't think this gate is closed. It's open. It's open. It is said one of the reasons for the revelation of this ayah was that a man came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa sallam. He came and he said, Ya Rasulullah, I committed a very bad sin and I don't think Allah will forgive me. He said, why not? He said, what's greater, the mountains or your sin? He said, no, my sin is greater than the mountains. He said, what's greater, the mercy of Allah or your sin? He said, I think my sin is greater than the mercy of Allah. So the Prophet became angry at him. He told him, woe upon you, how can you say this? We read in Dua Kumail in the first sentence, Allahumma inni as'aluka bi rahmatika allati wasi'at kull shay. I ask you by, which comes from the Quran. Allah says, wa rahmati wasi'at kull shay. My mercy encompasses everything. Amir al-Mu'mineen starts with this ayah in his words, in his own words. Allahumma inni as'aluka bi rahmatika allati wasi'at kull shay. I ask you by your mercy which has encompassed everything. So how beautiful he starts the dua. So he tells him, the Prophet told this man, Allah's mercy encompassed everything. He said, not my sin, Ya Rasulullah. And he started crying. The Prophet told him, what is your sin? Tell me. He said, Ya Rasulullah, I steal kafans. When they bury someone, I go at night and steal their kafan. He said, last night, they buried a lady from the Ansar, this was in Medina. This man's name was Bahlul, Bahlul al-Nabbash. Nabbash means the one who digs the graves. He said, last night they buried a beautiful young lady from the Ansar. So I went, I dug her grave and I stole her kafan. When I stole the kafan, Shaitan came to me, Iblis came to me and said, this is such a beautiful lady. Why leave her alone? So wal'iyadu billah, he performed the ma'asiyah. He said, then I heard a voice telling me that what will you say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of judgment for what you have done? He said, that moved me, Ya Rasulullah. Now I'm here, I don't know what to do. The Prophet became upset with him. He said, how dare you do such an act? So he became so embarrassed from Rasulullah and he ran away. He ran away to the desert. He said, he tied himself to a rock in a chain. And he said, I will not let myself go unless I either die or Allah forgives me. He stayed there for 40 days doing istighfar, ibadah, praying, until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down the ayah and he told him, Ya Rasulullah, go tell this man, Bahlul, we've forgiven him. He's been forgiven for his act. So the Prophet said to the Muslims, go find him. They went, they found him chained to this rock. They found that his color has changed. He's become dark from the sun. His color changed. And they found him in a state about to leave this dunya. But they came and they told him the good news. They said, Ya Bahlul, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forgiven you. The Prophet has forgiven you. Come back. So the ayah, it is said, was revealed. وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا فَعَلُوا فَاحِشَةً أَوْ ظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ ذَكَرُوا اللَّهِ فَاسْتَغْفَرُوا لِذُنُوبِهِمْ وَمَنْ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. But there is an important factor here. وَلَمْ يُصِرُوا عَلَى مَا فَعَلُوا وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ. Just so that Muslims do not get the wrong concept where, let me do any sin I want and then I can do istighfar. No problem. No problem. That's what Umar ibn Sa'ad said. Umar ibn Sa'ad said, I can kill Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. I'll kill him and then I'll do tawbah. I'll do istighfar. Allah responds to this argument. He says, وَلَمْ يُصِرُّوا عَلَىٰ مَا فَعَلُوا وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ.
They don't insist on repeating and committing the sin knowingly, deliberately. So there is a condition for tawbah, for istighfar. Yes, you turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but you have to be genuine. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا تُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ تَوْبَةً نَصُوحًا. O believers, when you repent to Allah, make it a genuine repentance, that you don't go back to committing the same act again. I don't say I'm going to stop looking at the haram, I do istighfar and then I have the intention tomorrow I'll repeat the same act again. No, be genuine with Allah. And that's what the ayah is trying to do. This suggests that even in the society of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, you had social problems. Even in his society there were social problems. Yet he was the man of medicine. He was the counselor. He was the psychologist. He was the doctor who can help those people. So they came back to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, seeking istighfar, seeking purification, seeking tawbah. So the Prophet had these institutions, or quote-unquote institutions in place, so people can come back to Islam, so people can wake up from their sins and they can be forgiven. It is said that when this ayah was revealed, Iblis went on a mountain in Mecca, a big mountain, went on top of this mountain, and he called his companions, the shayateen, he called them for a convention. Similar to the conventions we see in this day and age, you know, in this day and age, every now and then there is a convention of some sort, you know, to help some country here, help some country there. People come to these conventions, smile, shake each other's hands, take some photos and whatever, and then all of a sudden you find one area is being bombed, another area is being killed, another area is being deprived, and so on and so forth. Nonetheless, so they held a convention. They looked at Iblis, they said, "Ya Iblis, why do we see you so distressed? How come you're so angry?" He said, "Haven't you heard the latest ayah that was revealed?" He said, "Which ayah?" He said, "This ayah. Those, when they commit a sin, a major sin, a minor sin, do istighfar, and Allah will forgive them. This means we work so hard to deviate people, to make them commit a sin, and then they turn to Allah, they do istighfar, all our work is gone. Now doesn't that make you angry?" They said, "Yes, Ya Iblis, this is really a big deal." He said, "We need to deal with this ayah. How are we going to deal with it?" So one of the shayateen raised his hand, said, "I will take care of it." "How?" He said, "I'll do so and so." He said, no, this is not good." Another shaytan raised his hand, said, "I'll do so and so." He said, "No, this is also not good." A third shaytan by the name of Al-Waswasul Khannas, قل أعوذ برب الناس ملك الناس إله الناس من شر الحمد لله. ما شاء الله, you have it memorized, والحمد لله. Very good, very good, ما شاء الله. مؤمنين, good, you're not sleeping, والحمد لله رب العالمين. They say it was, they asked a man, they said, "Do you memorize the Quran?" He said, "I memorized it from cover to cover." He said, "How? ما شاء الله, the whole thing?" He said, "No, I only حمد الناس, you know, this cover and that cover, you know, ما شاء الله." So may Allah bless you. Inshallah, you're not among that person, you know. Okay. Recite a salawat for yourself.
Allahumma salli ala.
Those mu'min who are sleeping there in the corner, I don't want to say over and say another salawat so he wakes up as well, inshallah.
Don't sleep.
To hasten the reappearance of our 12th Imam Ajjalallah Ta'ala Farajahu Sharif, recite a third love salawat. So this waswas al-khannas alladhi waswasu fi sudur al-nas, he comes and he whispers in the hearts of people. This waswas al-khannas. He said, "Ya Iblis, I will take care of this ayah." He said, "How? What are you going to do?" He said, "First, I'm going to come and whisper to the mu'mineen to commit a ma'siyah, to commit a sin. Once they commit the sin, then I will make them forget about istighfar and tawbah. And this way, that's it. They won't repent. And that's why in Munajat al-Shakin, the second Munajat of Sahifa al-Sajjadiyya, Imam al-Sajjad, we should be reading these Munajat. They're beautiful, amazing Munajat. Ways for us to speak to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Munajat al-Ta'ibin, the first one. Munajat al-Shakin, the second one. The sixth one, Munajat al-Shakirin. Gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Beautiful Munajats. How many of us spend some time reading them? In fact, some people may not have even heard of them. Nonetheless, Munajat al-Shakin, the second Munajat. Imam al-Sajjad says, Ya Allah, I complain to you of a nafs, of my nafs, which really makes me rush to commit a sin and procrastinates when it comes to tawbah. That's a problem. We should always be alert. This institution, Allah kept it there for us to rehabilitate ourselves. If I said something against a mu'min or a mu'mina, let me go clean my act and do istighfar. If I took the money of a mu'min or a mu'mina, let me pay it back to them and do istighfar. If I have not paid my khums in my life and I've taken imam's money in my stomach, let me do istighfar and pay it back. If I am an individual, wal-iyadu billah, who had not prayed, let me go back and do istighfar. If I am an individual who, wal-iyadu billah, performs certain sins, a person who drinks alcohol, does drug addiction, let them have the strength and the willpower to stop doing this action and do istighfar. Turn to Allah. If there is a lady, a mu'mina, who does not want to wear the hijab because she takes it so lightly, the issue of not wearing the hijab, let her do istighfar and put it on. If there is a youth who listens to music, the haram music, and looks at the haram things, let them determine not to do that and do istighfar. It's a rehabilitation. They rehab themselves. And this institution, Allah kept it so people can go back to Allah. And it's an extremely important institution, because this institution can transform a life of an individual, wal-iyadu billah, from being a asi, a fasiq, a disobedient servant, into an obedient servant who is muttaqi, abid, salih. And on the day of Ashura, we see a beautiful example of this institution and its demonstration, how beautiful it is, with Hur ibn Yazid al-Riyahi. Al-Hur, he was really contemplating what to do. A man by the name of Al-Muhajir ibn Aus. He says, I was standing next to Hur on the day of Ashura. I saw him trembling, shaking. He said, I looked at Hur. I told him, Ya Hur, إن سألوني من أشجع شجعان الكوفة أو من أشجع فرسان الكوفة لما عدوتك. Said, Ya Hur, if they ask me who is the bravest man in Kufa, I would not hesitate to respond that it is Al-Hur ibn Yazid al-Riyahi. Brave man, a brave knight, a warrior. He said, but what is this that I'm seeing from you? You trembling. I've never seen you in this state, shaking. قال أخير نفسي بين الجنة والنار ولا أختار على الجنة شيئا. Said, I am contemplating, I am asking myself, debating, I'm having this conflict in my heart between Jannah and between Nar, paradise or wal'iyadu billah, hellfire, between Hussein and between Ubaidillah ibn Ziyad. That conflict is happening in my heart. But he said, he made up his mind. He said, وَلَا أَخْتَارُ عَلَى الْجَنَّةِ شَيْئًا. I will not choose anything over Jannah. So he kicks his horse, heading towards the camp of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein alayhi salam. Al-Muhajir says, initially I thought he wanted to go and attack. He wanted to attack. He said, however, as he approached Abi Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam, we find him putting his hand over his head. And he comes to Abi Abdullah alayhi salam and he says, Ya ibn Rasulullah, Ana sahibuka alladhi ja'ja'a bika al-tariq. I am the one who intercepted your path. I am the one responsible for bringing you to Karbala. I am the one responsible for bringing your women and children over here. I am the one responsible for those enemies of Allah attacking you. But here I am seeking tawbah. Do I have a chance, Ya Ibn Rasulullah? Can I go through this institution of tawbah to rehab myself, to cleanse my actions? And look at what Abu Abdullah alayhi salam says to him. He looks at him like a father looking at his son. And he tells him, Ya hur, in tubt, tab Allahu alayk. If you are genuinely seeking repentance, then Allah will forgive you. Welcome to my camp. Brothers and sisters, this move in the last few hours or minutes in the life of this man transformed him from an individual where we stand and say, لَعَنَ اللَّهُ أُمَّةً قَتَلَتْكَ وَلَعَنَ اللَّهُ أُمَّةً ظَلَمَتْكَ. From that individual, from this group, to a group where we stand and say, بِأَبِي أَنْتَ وَأُمِّي. May my mother and my father be sacrificed for you, Ya Hur. Not only us, even the fuqaha, the maraji', the ulama, when they do the ziyarah of the ashab, they say, بِأَبِي أَنْتَ وَأُمِّي. All this transformation, few minutes, is this transformation. And this gate, this is institution of tawbah, the institution of tawbah. Then he tells Imam al-Husayn, Ya Aba Abdullah, since I was the first man to intercept your path, I would like to have the honor of being the first man to die in your way, Ya Aba Abdullah. And indeed, he fought bravely until he got killed. Salamullahi alayhi. And then Imam al-Husayn walked to him just before he leaves this dunya. And he told him, Ya Hur, bakhin laka Ya Hur. Anta al-Hur kama sammatka ummuk. Hurun fi al-dunya wa sa'idun fi al-akhira. Hur, well done, congratulations. Indeed, you're a free man like your mother has named you, free from your desires. And you'll be happy in the hereafter. And then the companions of Abi Abdullah al-Husayn started coming one after the other, bidding their farewell to Abi Abdullah al-Husayn. At one point, a man by the name of Muslim ibn Awsaja, he comes to Imam al-Husayn. He says, Ya Aba Abdullah, give me the permission to fight before you and defend the message of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam gives him the permission. He goes back and fights bravely until he is heavily wounded. He falls on the plains of Karbala. Imam al-Husayn walks to him along with Habib ibn Madahir al-Asadi. He said, Ya Muslim, may Allah bless you. Habib said to him, Ya Muslim, if I know that I will be living much longer after you, I would have liked you to give me your will. He looked at Habib. He raised his weak hand and pointed at Abi Abdullah al-Husayn. And he said, Habib, Allah, Allah, bihad al-gharib.
قاتل حتى تقتل دون حبيب. Take care of the stranger man. أبي عبد الله غريب كربلاء. Make sure you fight before him, defending him until you lose your life. And then his soul departed his body. Imam al-Hussein cried and said, رحمك الله يا مسلم. Muslim, may Allah have mercy upon you. You fought before us when you were alive, and you made us in your will when you died. Then the companions came, another companion by the name of Wahab. Wahab was a Christian man. He came on the day of Ashura, became a Muslim, along with his new bride of 2 weeks and his mother. They became Muslims, and he came to Abi Abdullah al-Hussein saying, Ya Abu Abdullah, give me the permission to fight and die before you. His wife hung on to him. She said, Ya Wahab, I'm your new bride. How can you leave me in this world alone? But his mother told him, Ya Wahab, don't listen to her. Go defend the son of Fatima, so that on the day of judgment you make me proud in front of my master Fatima al-Zahra alayha salam. Wahab then goes and fights in the battle until he loses his four fingers. He comes back to his mother. He says, Mother, I've lost my four fingers. Are you pleased with me? She said, No, I am not pleased until you lose your life defending Abi Abdullah al-Hussein. At that moment, he wanted to head back to the battle. His wife came and she hung on to him. She took a pillar of a tent and she said, Ya Wahab, I will come and join you and fight to defend Abi Abdullah al-Hussein. He looked at her surprised. He said, Ya lady, oh my wife, what is the matter? What changed you? Few minutes ago you were telling me not to leave you. Now you want to join me and defend Abi Abdullah al-Hussein. She said, Ya Wahab, la talumni, inna wa'iyat al-Hussein adamat qalbi. Ya Wahab, don't blame me. The cry of Abi Abdullah tore my heart into pieces. He said, What did you hear him saying? She said, I heard Abi Abdullah crying, Amam mu'in yu'inuna, Amam nasir yansurna, Amam talib liljannati yatlubuna. Isn't there anyone to help us? Isn't there anyone to support us? O Shia of Hussein, Imam al-Hussein is calling you. Let us all cry, Aywa Husayna, Aywa Imama, Aywa Sayyida. Ya Wahab, when I heard the call of Abi Abdullah, I couldn't help but to come and defend Abi Abdullah al-Hussein. Then Wahab told Abi Abdullah, Ya Abu Abdullah, tell my wife to go back to the tent. Imam al-Hussein told her, May Allah bless you, O lady. Go back to the tent. Jihad is not wajib amongst you. Until he got killed, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim. Then another man who was a Turkish slave, he came to Abi Abdullah asking him for the permission to fight. He went to the battle. When he was heavily wounded, he fell on the plains of Karbala. Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam walked to him. In his last moments, Abi Abdullah put his cheek on the cheek of this Turkish slave. Ya mu'min. He opened his eyes in his last moment. He smiled at Abi Abdullah. قال من مثلي وخد ابن رسول الله على خدي. Who is like me and the cheek of Abi Abdullah is touching my cheek. And that's when his soul departed his body. Then the companions one after the other started coming until the last two were left with Abi Abdullah. Two two companions, two brothers, they came to Imam al-Hussein. They were crying. They said, Ya Abu Abdullah, give us the permission to go to fight and defend you, Ya Abu Abdullah al-Hussein. Imam al-Hussein told them, why are you crying then? Are you afraid of death? They said, no, Ya Abu Abdullah, but we are the last two companions left with you. Once we die, you will have no more supporters, no more companions. We are worried about you, Ya Abu Abdullah. Imam al-Hussein told them, may Allah bless you. Go ahead, fight to defend the religion of Rasulullah. And shortly after, I will be joining you with my grandfather, Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Then he stood there in the battle, looking around, crying, Habib, Burair, Zuhair, Mali, أدعوكم فلا تجيبون. Why am I calling you and you're not responding back to me? This is your master, Abi Abdullah al-Hussein. But how can you respond when your heads have been separated from your bodies? Ah, نذرا علي لئن عادوا وإن رجعوا لأزرعن طريقا.
إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون. والعاقبة للمتقين. مؤمنين مؤمنات. Raise your hands now. Imam al-Hussein عليه السلام is calling, do we have any supporters? And inshallah, we're among those supporters. We pray to Allah by the holiness and the greatness of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein to make us and our progeny until the day of judgment among the Shia of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein, the supporters of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein, among those who are martyred with Abi Abdullah al-Hussein in the path of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein. This is the time, inshallah, when dua is accepted. Raise your hands and everyone with me together, all boys, girls, men, women, children. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أما يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء. أما يجيب المضطر إذا دعا ويكشف السوء. أما يجيب المضطر إذا دعا أما يجيب المضطر إذا دعا ويكشف السوء. أما يجيب المضطر إذا دعا ويكشف. اللهم إنا نسألك وندعوك باسمك العظيم الأعظم الأعز الأجل الأكرم 10 times. يا الله 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 يا إلهي بفاطمة وأبيها وبعلها وبنيها والسر المستودع فيها اكشف عنا السوء يا الله. اللهم بالحسين الشهيد اغفر ذنوبنا يا الله. كفر عنا سيئاتنا وتوفنا مع الأبرار يا الله. إلهي بالحسين الشهيد اجعلنا وذريتنا إلى يوم الدين من شيعة الحسين المتقين يا الله ومن خدمة الحسين المخلصين يا الله. إلهي بالحسين الشهيد اقض حوائج المؤمنين والمؤمنات. شافي وعافي جميع مرضى المؤمنين والمؤمنات من أوصونا بالدعاء من المؤمنين والمؤمنات. اللهم آمنهم في ديارهم
احفظهم في اوطانهم، انصرهم على اعدائهم، اقضي حوائجهم، شافي مرضاهم، ارحمهم برحمتك الواسعة يا ارحم الراحمين. رب اغفر لي ولوالدي وارحمهما كما ربياني صغيرا، اجزهما بالإحسان إحسانا وبالسيئات غفرانا. رب اجعلني مقيم الصلاة ومن ذريتي، ربنا وتقبل دعاء. اللهم عجل لوليك الفرج، واجعلنا من شيعته وأنصاره وأعوانه والمستشهدين بين يديه. اللهم كن لوليك حجة ابن الحسن، صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة، وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا، حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم أرنا الطلعة الرشيدة والغرورة الحميدة، واكحل أنظارنا بنظرة منا إليه. اللهم نقسم عليك بالزهراء فاطمة، إلا ما رزقتنا شفاعة الزهراء يا الله يا الله يا الله، لقضاء الحوائج ولشفاء المرضى ولكشف هذه الغمة عن هذه الأمة ولتعجيل فرج مولانا صاحب العصر والزمان، وإلى أرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات لا سيما أرواح أموات الجالسين والحاضرين والمؤسسين. رحم الله من يقرأ السورة المباركة الفاتحة مع الصلوات. Thank you.